As John McMurtry puts it, behind the selection and development of technology's advances over every step of its planning, design, assembly, manufacture, and displacement of past ways of life stands one commanding value decision: to maximize the difference between input and output of money demand in market investment sequences. In other words, if the technological advent, A, has the potential or even short-term negative retroaction on money output, B, it is selected against by a company, or by the market, or by a person, as a matter of pure economic survival. This is true of any society based on monetary requirements to survive, and we call it competitive deselection. In other words, needless to say, any revision to a company's offering would require heavy restructuring, heavy staff turnover and retraining, and true innovation, therefore, inevitably, heavy investment. Would be in the short term, in many cases, a costly or negative effect upon the balance sheet, given that many companies' results are often offered quarterly and have an immediate impact on the share price if they're below the expected maximized money output to input ratio. The dominant market ideology has to select against a ground-up remodeling of the market offering to avoid this negative effect upon its stock. Equally, this is, of course, true of technologies or market behaviors from outside the company, which may threaten the normal way in which said company would be able to generate revenues, even if it has a positive force upon society. Anything that changes or threatens your business is considered a problem. Innovation is the enemy of established institutions, quite a simple way of putting that. So, when digital downloads provide a more beneficial and efficient means of content distribution than prior hardware, it is opposed and criminalized. Despite the speed of ease, the size that you can consume, ease of access by anyone with a computer, savings in plastic, transportation, storage, the dominant music companies sue individuals for criminality and lobby the government for protection of their industry, judging this to be the best way to guard their profits. Thereby, they hope to scare the rest of the consumer base into sticking with what is best for the established market. Not because they're evil, it's their job. It's the survival of those employed in that market. They stick with the familiar. Even more starkly, should a solution for a problem come to the floor that would cancel the need for an existing service that hitherto only treated or rather than solved the problem in question, it is shunted to the side, often by employing the full force of law propaganda. This all too often falls into the hands of advertising. Bottled water is a quick fix with recurring profits for water companies, while desalination and purification plants that would enable an abundance of water for all humanity and all uses is considered a risk to business rather than what it actually is, a necessity for survival. In turn, we produce more plastic waste, which is then measured in the positive light of units manufactured and sold, rather than their actual effect, a pollution detriment and an increased footprint caused by the treatment of the problem. The end effect of this market lock mentality is not really hard to discern. You cannot set in motion long-term thinking in a system which rewards short-term behaviors. While human beings have to support themselves from the monetary profit of their enterprises, no matter how decoupled these enterprises are from producing something that is useful, or the harm on basic life organization to the environment, short-term wins every time. There is no money in solutions or learning to produce and consume less. For either you lose too much money and you're removed from the position you're in, or you are ostracized completely, as were our doomed engineers. The system's overriding logic is to deselect the non-profit maximizing solution, for we cannot afford to tolerate it in a system that discerns the metrics for positive growth in the factors of higher consumption, higher profits, more units shifted. The first limiter then is established: market lock. The innovation that threatens established institutions are criminalized, ignored, hamstrung and suppressed by the established institutions whose market value would be, even if only temporarily, slowed or curbed by their adoption. This is regardless of how effective, efficient or beneficial these innovations are or would be in a society adopting them. In fact, the more beneficial, advancing or efficient the new development would be, the more it is pushed back by the elements of society that would be within the sphere of its influence. Second limiter to innovation and its progress lies a little more deeply within the societal mindset than the monetary paradigm, and it's just as invisible. This is one we like to call mind lock. This is the tendency alluded to by Dr. Wayne Dyer in his address that you heard in that portion of Pixar's Day and Night, and which is also keenly expressed once again by John McMurtry. When people come to examine any way of life in the world, they are conditioned not to expose their own social order to that same critical eye with which they view a different or opposed social order. This is because they identify with their own way of life as normality, and thus the other as abnormality. If the other is not only different, but also opposed to the home order, then to abnormality is added the offence of enmity. Given that there is such an abundance of examples of systemic failure in society, why have we not easily moved beyond it? The question comes down to more than just money, as a powerful barrier that it is. Societal self-analysis is not built into our psyche. It is an irreversible option in our critique of planetary life. We do not like to talk of how our society might be less than perfect. We don't even like those who criticize our football teams. Tell someone that their social system is geared towards something other than complete chest-swelling awesomeness, and you're often told that if you don't like it, you can just get out. It's the social theory version of, well, I think you're a dick. Yeah, it's like that. Normal is normal. Normal can't be what could be said to be necessary for scrutiny. As we look outwards from our societal perspective, we do not factor in the preconditions of convention and presuppositions which have been arbitrarily born and raised into. What is normality? You were all born at 1,044 miles an hour. The rotational speed of the Earth. Yet you believe you're static sitting in those chairs right there. When you stand up, you're actually standing outwards. Downwards is actually inwards. The sun doesn't set or rise. We're at a different position in the universe every single minute. It appears then that we can get used to just about anything. This then is what I mean by normality. Much of society appears pretty much normal to its inhabitants and therefore natural or inevitable, not begging questions. What is considered by any of us to be mundane or a given becomes mundane or a given only by repetition, and whatever we are always surrounded by defaults to that status. A few years ago, a television program traded on this possibility of showing an unaccustomed culture confronted by a modern city system, the viewer would consider normal and unsurprising. By dropping a culturally unprepared group of Amish people into a modern high-tech city environment where they're confronted by vending machines and escalators, the show's attempt at exposing the humorous response of culture shock and societal unpreparedness actually underlines a very deeper issue of general custom. The culture shock is a product of a non-initiated standpoint and becomes at once surprising and almost unbelievable. One can't imagine an unknowing fear of an escalator's basic operation. Even my daughter loves playing with them, for one has never not been used to them. Additionally, we tend to assume that our societal level of trust and coherence exists that would mean that dangerous architecture or hazardous obstacles are minimized. Therefore, we trust that escalators will not mangle us, that lifts will not plummet 18 floors suddenly, that any household item will not explode when used. There we go. Or plugged in. And that our house will not collapse when we are about to open the front door. Over and above these general trust and belief systems in established cultural aspects is the established values which operate and which are also bought into with the same level of trust as the physical ones. Amongst them may be the following. The army are fighting for my freedom. Surveillance is for the provision of safety. Advertising is a means to educate me, for example, about the best way of looking after my health, and so on. Amongst them, more often than not, is also the general value that it's highly unlikely to me that the values of the surrounding social order are or would be harmful, misleading, predatory, or detrimental to me and my fellow inhabitants. For to believe that the values are out of order would be to appear to be rather paranoid and what is tellingly called antisocial. There must be something wrong with you if you don't support the structure and find it predatory. After all, that's not what a society's about, is it? What we consider to be our values are, in fact, arbitrary conditioning byproducts of, on one extreme, which evolve out of our need to feel perpetually our need not to feel perpetually worried and surprised and disorientated by the regularly appearing environment and cultural attributes, and on the other extreme are deliberately reinforced by the dominant perspective of the ruling social order. As Dr. Gabor Maté puts it, what you have to understand about an intellectual culture of a society is that it actually reflects the power interests in that society, the dominant perspective. And built right into the dominant value structure is the taboo of questioning the authority by which it is delivered. Fear of the unknown and fear of ostracism ensure that the advent of new opinions, new realizations, or anything that is new at all is met with discomfort, fear, even anger. And it's true of every existing society to get today. Again, McMurtry, this block against exposing the habituated and socially constructed self, and more deeply, the regulating order which has constructed it, is a transcultural problem. Here is our second limiter to add to the first: market lock. Resting within and under the market system shared by most of this planet is the culture blindness of basic societal functional analysis, our values, the mind lock. It is the inability and ill-equipped nature to understand how the system is operating around us and how our views are being informed by it. Third and finally, there is the sphere of education, something which Jim Phillips has dealt with in the applied sense. By education, I don't simply mean school, university, and grades, and cheating, but also the methods of the distribution of information that exist within a society, including schools, universities, television, radio, internet-based media, films and documentaries, books, printed material, conversations, and so on. Education, in my sense, is the systemic assimilation and distribution of information within a society, the furthering of any knowledge and its modification, adjustment, development, and redistribution. It is what you learn from the daily interaction with that society, whether it's through a concerted and defined institution like a school, or personal endeavor like a book or a science kit, or leisure, be it what you are told by others or by television programs, what they display to you. As James Phillips has dealt with in his lecture a bit more detailed, education is often believed to be somehow separate from culture, a supra-societal, free of the biases of tradition, myth, and so on. Whereas, in fact, education is in many of its areas a product of culture. One need only to really read a history book written under communist rule or the modern American school system to witness this bias. Not only are the teachers, journalists, and authors and so on, all victims of that culture, but the syllabus of an institution born of a traditional society with set doctrines is itself a machine that pumps out information well below the rate of actual advance that the society experiences, which is, as discussed already, hindered by the previously discussed mechanism of market lock.